Hello, welcome to another episode of A Spot of Science. As always, I'm Gus.
I'm Chris.
And I'm Sally.
And this week, this episode is brought to you by Blue Apron. Not all ingredients are created equal. Fresh, high-quality ingredients make a real difference, so it's important to know where your food comes from. For less than $10 per person per meal, Blue Apron delivers seasonal recipes along with pre-portioned ingredients to make delicious home-cooked meals. Choose from a variety of new recipes each week, or let Blue Apron's culinary team surprise you. Recipes are not repeated within a year, so you'll never get bored. Blue Apron's freshness guarantee promises that every ingredient in your delivery arrives ready to cook, or they will make it right. Check out this week's menu and get your first three meals free with free shipping by going to blueapron.com/bitesize. You'll love how good it feels and tastes to create incredible home-cooked meals with Blue Apron, so don't wait. That's blueapron.com/bitesize. Blue Apron, a better way to cook. Well, why don't we get started? Question one was sent in by Murphy. It says, if you taught a male and female monkey sign language and then allowed the two monkeys to mate, would they teach their child sign language?
I think...
Now, you know.
Yes. I know that it would happen, but only if the monkeys were, like, the smart... I think if the smart monkeys were... They'd have to be equally smart monkeys.
Right? So you need to have two smart monkeys. It wouldn't work with a smart and a dumb monkey.
No, because if one of them was dumb, then he would... If one of them was dumb, this like the smart one, like the girl, would not, they'd fight over who could do sign language better, and so they wouldn't.
Are we talking about the parents here or the kids?
The parents, yeah.
We know that both the parents can do sign
both
language.
Both parents though. Know how to do sign language, yeah. But if one of them wasn't smart enough to pass that knowledge onto their daughter or son, monkey, this is confusing.
Yeah, I don't know what's going on with you.
Yes.
But they had to be smart.
They have to be smart monkeys, and then their kid also has to be a smart kid. And I think it also be a situation where they need to only, I don't think they would teach all the languages. I think it only teach things like food and go to the bathroom and more commands that a parent would deal with their son.
Stuff that monkeys need to know, like where to go to the bathroom.
Yeah, it's a very need to know thing. I think there's a lot of, when people teach sign language to monkeys, I think they teach like extra languages
you know
that
they
may
teach
not,
sign language.
They may not need all that language.
Okay.
Like what is a need to know thing for a monkey?
Food and where to go to the bathroom
and like where to like you know have private time.
What do you think about that, Sally? Wait, where to go to have private time? You just like snuck that one in at the end. Anyway,
sliding in. I mean, you're not entirely wrong, which is good. I think the first thing to point out is that in the question, it's saying, okay, so if we've got a male monkey that knows sign language and a female monkey that knows sign language. I'm going to switch the word monkey here for ape because pretty much the ones that have been taught sign language so far have been apes. They're not monkeys, and that is a big distinction I always like to make.
So
they're not the same thing.
What's the difference between an ape and a monkey?
Both of them are primates. The apes include the great apes, which are chimpanzees, bonobos, humans, orangutans, western and eastern gorilla, and then the gibbons, which are the lesser apes. They just discovered a new species of gibbon, so I think there's now 18 species of gibbon. Everything else is a monkey, unless it's a loris or a tarsier or a lemur. Those are the non-monkey primates.
As a general rule, could you say apes are the bigger primates?
Apes
and
are the ones
are the
without tails, oh, okay. As a general rule, but things like macaques are monkeys that don't have tails.
Okay.
But in general, so the great apes are the famous ones. The gibbons are the other ones, and everything else is a monkey,
okay.
Pretty much. But because the great apes are the ones with the ridiculous levels of intelligence, those are the ones that we've taught sign language to. But the question was asking, okay, so if we mate one with another, will they teach it to their kid? Well, actually, they don't. It's not a genetic thing. So it's not a matter of, okay, if we've taught this one language, it will be passed on in their genes. The child will learn language. But... we have a couple of examples of teaching chimpanzees human sign language, or gorilla sign, GSL is the actual name for it. Coco the gorilla is by far and away the most famous example of this. Like everyone has heard of Coco the gorilla. Yeah, have you?
Yeah.
So this is this female gorilla kept in a zoo, and they've taught her around 1,000 words in sign language, and she can sign them all, and she can combine them to make words, like compound words that won't have been discovered before. And this was all huge, big, famous thing. She famously had a pet kitten and she was very sad when it died and all that kind of thing. They also taught a bonobo called Kanzi, a male bonobo, and instead of teaching him sign language with his hands, they used, I think it's called a lexigram or a lexigraph, where they press little pictorial symbols, and that speaks out the sound. Okay. So it's pretty much pointing instead of like moving it, and he'll take his little sheet of symbols around everywhere he goes with him. But then what was written, so they thought, this is amazing, this bonobo, this type of chimp, has the understanding of language like around a 2 or 3 year old child, so a toddler, but still, that's pretty good. And then no one really noticed that he was doing these hand gestures until the woman that had taught Coco the gorilla sign language visited Kanzi and realized that Kanzi was speaking to her in gorilla sign language because he had watched videos of Coco. So he had taught himself sign language through watching the actions of another ape, which is like huge news, because when we're talking about trying to one animal trying to teach another animal, a huge part is, can they pick it up from another animal? Mm-hmm. So this shows that they can pick it up from another animal. And Kanzi has a son called Teko, and Teko is around the same human that's been training Kanzi, as well, and Teko also is being trained by his father. And so Teko's got both a human and a chimp teaching him, and he's learning amazingly well. So there have to be certain apes that are, they have certain kind of predispositions towards learning language. They do have to be the smart ones, like you were saying. Not every ape can learn sign language or any kind of human language, but they will learn them. And so a famous one was Kanzi was given kale once, because I don't know, maybe they wanted to keep involved in like the fads of the day. And he didn't have a word for kale on his little sheets. And so he pointed to sloe and lettuce because it took him so long to chew it. And so that's the kind of thing where that's why we think that it's not just a kind of, they point to something, they don't know what it means, but then they get a reward as a result. Kanzi's also been seen actually asking for the ingredients for an omelette and then cooking the omelette himself. Like, we're talking really sophisticated level stuff here.
So like Rise of the Planet of the Apes kind of stuff.
Kind of. I mean, he loves his owners and stuff. But it's amazing kind of working out what the limits are, but they are still toddlers. Like, it's not the human grasp of language.
Is the situation possible where we release these apes back into the wild, and all of a sudden we come back 20 years later and all the apes speak sign language?
It might be. So firstly, they've said that Kanzi would not survive in the wild. He is far too domesticated. Okay. Like, he
can't get his slow lettuce smoothies
exactly.
out of the jungle.
He is just living the life of luxury. He does not know how to live in the wild. But in other animals, there's certainly cultural learning. And so away from apes, if we move to blue tits, was a really famous example. We're going on to tits again.
Yay,
Rooster Teeth loves tits. So blue tits are a small little songbird in the UK with a little blue head. And they pretty much feed on insects and grubs and stuff like that. But in the old days when we used to have bottles, glass bottles of milk with little foil caps delivered to your door by a milkman, some blue tits somehow learned that the cream was at the top of the milk bottle was amazingly tasty, worked out how to pierce through the top of the milk bottles and drink the cream. And people started noticing, obviously, because they had holes in their milk. But then we watched the spread of this new idea across the UK as blue tits learned from other blue tits. And you could see who had been teaching who.
Oh,
and there's a huge thing being done in Oxford at the moment. We have this Whiteham Woods. It's a forest which is really heavily studied. And we are now teaching certain individuals certain tricks, like if there's a feeder, go to the red one. The red one's got food, not the black one. And you watch, like, is it the most popular individuals in the group? Because we know all of their social networks. Is it like the cool kids that are best at disseminating this knowledge? Or is it the kind of the loners who like to do their own thing? The mavericks, are they good ones to teach if you want to teach the whole population? So yeah, it's definitely the fact that animals can learn from each other, and they do all the time.
Were they teaching each other that, or were they observing other blue tits?
So this is an interesting, how do you define teaching? So teaching is typically defined as they're doing something in such a way that it's not purely for their own benefit, but learning can involve just observation. Mm-hmm. So the other blue tits were learning from the blue tits, but those blue tits weren't necessarily teaching
Got
them.
It. Okay.
Uh-huh. Yeah. So there's a whole load of teaching stuff.
Interesting. What we need to do is get the blue tits paired up with the gorillas, and then could they do that? Could that's a question. Could you ever have different animals teach each other I guess you could, huh?
So Coco taught Kanzi, in essence.
Oh, and it's a different...
And they're different species. One was a gorilla, one was a bonobo. Yeah, and the you must have seen the YouTube video of the orangutan sawing a piece of wood. It learned that through observing humans. And all of the, both Kanzi and Coco were taught by humans. So that's, again, cross-species.
True. So the next smartest animal is dolphin, right?
Depends how you define smart. I mean, they're up there.
They're SAT scores. Standardized testing.
Okay, yeah. Like, how many GCSEs did they get? Yeah.
Have we ever paired dolphins with gorillas?
Why, Chris? I'm just curious.
No, like, no. As in to see if they could identify, like, figure out that they're both really smart.
Well, you know the famous saying, like, if you judge every animal by how good it is at climbing trees, a fish will spend the whole of its life thinking it's stupid.
Yeah.
If you just stick a gorilla in with a dolphin, it will drown.
Well, I'm not saying it's like, not. I'm not like in the water.
Okay, so you take the dolphin out the water and then like, the gorilla.
You take it to SeaWorld.
Do you think, like, could they figure out some way to communicate with each other? Like, that would be cool to see a dolphin, a gorilla riding around on a dolphin.
I think humans already have trouble communicating with dolphins as it is. Anyway.
Yeah. I mean, the gorilla would certainly recognize it. So Coco had a pet kitten. And would know that it wasn't another gorilla. Mm-hmm. And so I would imagine that they've taught the gorilla the word for fish, for example, so they might describe it as big fish or something. But I don't think that they would be able to have a meaningful conversation, if only because the ways that dolphins communicate and the ways that apes communicate is quite different. So dolphins are very sound-based. Because you've got to imagine, what senses do they have? They don't have human senses. So they're underwater. Their sense of sound is very distorted. They have very good high pitch, so ultrasound that I imagine other apes can't hear. Their vision won't be so good depending on the species of dolphin. Whereas apes also have sound, but they also have a lot of grooming and tactile things.
So what about this?
Okay.
All right.
So the fingers out.
So, yeah. So you had the one monkey who had this the board that he pushed buttons, right?
Yeah.
The one ape with the board that pushed buttons that communicated. What if you taught a dolphin some basic like commands and things, and then had the gorilla with the buttons? They knew those same commands, and then the buttons made dolphin noises. So
they wouldn't even have to make. You could train the dolphin so that it recognized, say, flashing up the symbol. And the gorilla would know the same symbol. So you're saying that it would push that.
It would push the button.
And then, I mean, it's not been done. I doubt it would work, but there's no like underlying, it definitely will not work because of this reason. I think it's possible.
So it's possible.
Chris, are you going to quit Rooster Teeth now and write research papers, like try to get a grant to fund interspecies gorilla dolphin communication?
Well, that's cool though, right? The idea that we're teaching, we're like,
I think it'd be better to start within mammals, for example. So within,
but they are both mammals.
Actually, yeah, that's a really good point. See? Yeah, that is a really. Yeah. It's better to, within land mammals, I should say, or within primates, because then, like you always with science want to start off with the simplest problem first. Mm-hmm. So you first got to work out. Okay, so can say one smart gorilla teach a not so smart gorilla? Can a gorilla teach a gibbon or a macaque, or going kind of down the intelligence of monkeys and then try it with dolphins as well? I mean, it's a possible thing to do. I mean, we can't not mention the dolphin spending time in the house with the human that I know you have the animation for, because we brought it up on the last podcast.
I love it.
Have you heard, about the dolphin that spent time with humans and then just she gave it handjobs. But there's no reason why it shouldn't be a thing, but it's just not been done. It's implausible, but not impossible.
So if any of you work for, who are watching, work for academia and want to give Chris a grant to fund this, let us know.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it's about time to wrap up this episode of A Spot of Science. Thanks, everyone, for watching. We'll see you guys next time. And if you have any questions you'd like us to tackle, just send us an email to sciencespot@roosterteeth.com.